So we're finishing our sermon series on the generous life, how to activate, take action, have awareness, and impact the world around us. I have a couple things up here this morning because people have been so generous. And I walked into the chapel service this morning and went up to the podium, and lo and behold, there was a brownie on the podium. And you know, I think I need to make a clarification. So, but it all has to do with generosity. And then later in the service, at the end of the service, somebody gave me a wonderful cookie that I'm going to try as well. I'm just being blessed beyond measure, I'm just saying. And so this week somebody asked me, so are brownies your favorite dessert? And I said, actually, no, it's not. My favorite all-time dessert is the bread pudding that my grandmother made from scratch, from leftovers. And I don't think there's anybody in our family or the world that could remake that recipe. She has gone to be with the Lord. It's been 25 years ago now, but that's a dessert I'll never have again until I get to heaven. And I just think that was my favorite recipe because of my relationship with my grandmother. And brownies come in second best. And it's not because of the chocolatey flavor or the texture or the taste, truly. It has everything to do with my experience coming to Christ. You see, our small group leader invited us. I say our small group leader. He wasn't really our small group leader until he did the invitation. He invited my wife and I to his house for a Bible study each week. And every week, without fail, there was a fresh pot of coffee and fresh, warm brownies. And, you know, John Wesley would call that prevenient grace. And I would say amen. And so, all kidding aside, every time I bite into a warm, fresh brownie, I'm reminded of his generosity and his willingness to open his doors to a stranger and to share the gospel. To encourage, to listen, to put up with me. Because I asked a lot of silly questions, and I was combative. But he just extended grace, coffee, and brownies. And I think, oh my goodness, if it worked on me, it might work on other people as well. Thank you for being so generous. Thank you for being so generous. I think it's so important to recognize this last part of what a generous life can do. A generous life can have a lasting impact. I believe an eternal impact. I was headed down the wrong road, and because of somebody's generosity, the impact is why I'm here today. And I hope and pray that I too will have some kind of impact like that. Living generously can truly open the floodgates of the best version of life possible. I truly believe that. And it only consists of three steps: awareness, action, and the result being impact. And as I've stated previously, you don't have to be rich to be generous. All you have to do is be aware and then take action. It's pretty simple if you think about it. And since generosity isn't about money, I also made this statement. Generosity is for everybody, rich or poor. And so I'm going to share a couple reflections today, stories. True stories that actually happen. And I hope that you can see at some point through the stories the impact of generosity in overall thing. Now remember, there are seven ways that we can be generous. We can be generous with our thoughts. And that can start with our thoughts towards ourselves. And then our thoughts towards others. We can be generous with our words. We can either build people up or tear people down. Truly. We can be generous with our money. That's a no-brainer, right? We can be generous with our influence. We can be generous with our time, our attention, and even our belongings. So see if you can pick up any of those traits in this first story. Prefaced by Mark 16:15, Jesus said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." Anybody here know that? Now, if you were at the early service, don't raise your hand. But anybody here familiar with the name Edward Kimball? Oh, good. You guys haven't heard this story before. So in 1858, in Boston, there was a Sunday school teacher by the name of Edward Kimball. Now, Edward Kimball took it upon himself to really take awareness to a new level. He always poured into his Sunday school teacher, his Sunday school students, and he always offered each one an individual opportunity to accept the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ into their hearts. But he noticed one particular student who had to miss occasionally. And so he tracked him down, and he went into where he worked. It turned out that he had to work for the family business. So he found where he worked, and he went and visited it was a shoe shop. And he went into the back where this young student was, and he was stocking shelves. And he said, "I want to tell you about Jesus Christ." Then he prayed with him. And that student accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. That student's name was Dwight L. Moody. Anybody ever hear that name? Yeah. Well, Moody went on to preach internationally, and he was preaching in a small chapel over in the British Isles to a pastor by the name of Frederick Michael. And in his sermon, he told the story about how this Sunday school teacher brought the life of Jesus Christ into his heart, and he accepted it. And Meyer said that he was so impacted that he wanted to go and preach beyond what he was preaching. And he said, Pastor Meyer came to America in Northfield, Massachusetts, and he was preaching his sermon, and another young pastor in the group heard this quote: "If you are not willing to give up everything for Christ, are you willing to be made willing?" Let me repeat that. If you're not willing to give up everything for Christ, are you willing to be made willing? That led J. Wilbur Chapman to respond to God's call on his life. And he went into the ministry. Wilbur became a very effective evangelist. And he started crusades, and his crusades really took off. So he hired this young chap by the name of Billy Sunday. Anybody ever hear that name? Billy Sunday. Billy Sunday was so enamored by Wilbur Chapman's preaching that he became a preacher himself. And he went on to preach all around the world. And he preached in a town called Charlotte, North Carolina, to a group of Christian men, and his sermon was so powerful. I hope I get that powerful that day, someday. But his sermon was so powerful that a group of men took it upon themselves to take his message to their whole city. And so they created a revival, and they hired this guy by the name of Mordecai Ham. Anybody ever hear that name, Mordecai Ham? To come and preach for a week in a tent. And they had a revival. And so these Christian men gathered all kinds of teens around the neighborhood and took them every night to the tent to hear Mordecai Ham preach. There was one particular 16-year-old that was in the crowd that had gone every night. And he listened to what Mordecai Ham had said. And on the last night, he accepted Jesus Christ and felt a call to go into ministry. And that 16-year-old's name was Billy Graham. You ever hear the name of Billy Graham? Do you see how when we are generous with our influence and time and awareness, how it can have a ripple effect that can go beyond our understanding? Billy Graham has been credited with preaching the gospel to more people than anybody ever on earth. And I'm thinking, whoa, I don't know if I could ever get that famous, but if I did, it would be to the glory of God, not anything I could do on my own power. But I'm just saying, do we have any teachers in the crowd? Raise your hand if you're a teacher. I want you to know that you have the ability to influence your students. And how you teach, and how you act, and how you encourage may produce the next Billy Graham. I'm just saying, God has a plan for each one of you. It's up to you how you live into that plan. Can you be generous with your time, your awareness, and your abilities? The next story I want to share with you is, you know, one of the things that I failed to mention is, as I'm approaching these two stories, I'm trying to share with you what it's like to be a recipient of a life of generosity. And I think Billy Graham was one of those recipients. But he was also a participant. All those preachers and Sunday school teachers were participants in a generous life. And this next story includes all of you. Now last week, there was a gaggle of us, 10 of us, that went up to Ashland to a farm to pick 100 dozen ears of corn in 20 minutes or less. I say that because we got dumped on it. I mean, it rained really hard. 100 dozen. We brought it back, divvied it up, sold it all, and raised $1,045 for Sylvia Powell. It's applause and amen, even if it just comes from me. 1,045. So let me share with you how that money can impact a life. This story comes from Clarice, and I'll be looking at my notes because there's important parts of this story that I don't want to miss. Now, Clarice was a 12-year-old girl in Rwanda. Her mom and dad and oldest siblings were in jail, in prison, for crimes that they didn't commit. They were just in prison. She was left with her grandmother and two younger brothers. Her grandmother ended up passing away, like shortly after her parents and older siblings were in prison. And so there she was. The house that they had lived in had collapsed. Her grandmother was gone, and she had to do what was left or what was necessary to take care of those two boys. She couldn't do it anymore, so she climbed a mango tree and decided that she was going to take her life because that was the only way to stop the pain that she was experiencing. She figured that her brothers would be better off without her. And as she climbed up to a tall limb and secured the rope, ready to put the rope around her own neck, she heard somebody down below say, "Hey, hey, come on down." It was her neighbor. And she said, "No. There's nothing you can say, nothing you can do that's going to change my mind." And he kept pleading and promising, "We'll get through this. We'll figure it out somehow. You have to come down." And being a 12-year-old in Rwanda, she still was obedient to her elders, but she ended up coming down. And over the next couple weeks, the neighbor took her and her two siblings, her two little brothers, to a Zoe Empowers group. And it was evident, immediately evident, that they needed to provide grief counseling for her and her two brothers. And so they started to do that. And Clarice, for the first time, started to feel like she had a family. She started to feel like somebody cared. She no longer carried the stigma of the community as a thief or an orphan. And she was taught a trade to raise beans. She was given a grant and encouraged to plant and sow. And over the next couple years, within 3 years, she was self-sufficient and diversified her crops to include maize flour, peanut flour, tomatoes, corn, and other things. In fact, she was so successful that she was able to make sure the entire family had medical insurance, that her younger brothers were enrolled in school, that she was able to buy her own house and contribute back to her community. Even the perception of the community had changed because of Zoe Empowers and somebody being generous with her attention, time, and influence. You are a part of that by enjoying sweet corn, by seeing the movement of Christ in a distant place and wanting to be a part of that. I think amen. Amen. What a beautiful story to know that the richness of God, the abundance of God, is there for even the least who feel that there's no other place to turn than to Italy. And I thank you for being a part of that. Thank you for being generous. I pray that this would be the beginning of igniting the generous life that lives within each one of us. Some of us are already exhibiting it, and some of us are just starting. It doesn't matter where you're at on the spectrum. Just give thanks to God for all the generosity that He has poured out on us. And think about that generosity. The generosity of giving His Son for the sake of taking on the penalty of death for us so that we could have new life, abundant life. Not to hoard it, but to share the world. May we begin the journey that lives to living generously. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be a part of your movement. Thank you for a congregation that responds to the need around us. So thank you for the generosity of so many gifts that are being brought today to this worship service. And I thank you for the spark of generosity that begins in a new life in Christ. May that spark that lies within each one of us become brighter and brighter and brighter, so that we could abide in the words that Jesus said, "Let your light shine before us, so the world would know of our love." In His beautiful name we pray.